Happy Saturday, risers. We hope you're having a phenomenal weekend. Saagar and I are back with some of our favorite moments from the week.
This week, author Alec McGillis, he joined us to discuss his new book, Fulfillment. It's Winning and Losing in One-Click America. He explained how large corporations like Amazon have destroyed smaller local economies.
Dayton's a very good example. Dayton was a city that was, you know, sort of the Silicon Valley of its time in the late 19th, early 20th century, the Wright brothers, all that, and it's now really become more sort of just like a logistics hub. It's a town that, instead of sort of inventing and making things, is now sort of a place where things get packaged and transported. Another place I focus on is this the extraordinary story of Sparrows Point, which is this peninsula outside Baltimore that was once home to the largest steel mill in the entire world, 30,000 people. Making steel, living in a company town of 5,000 or 6,000 people, that's all been wiped completely clean off this peninsula, and it's now been replaced by a huge logistics business park, including two Amazon warehouses. And I actually spent a lot of time with a man who worked at the steel mill for 30 years, making $35 an hour, then went to work at the Amazon warehouse, making $13, $14, $15 an hour, wow. And finally quit because he couldn't take it anymore.
Such important book.
Amazon is transforming this country in ways that we cannot even imagine. I mean, they basically dominate the labor force. Yeah. They dominate consumer retail. They dominate what your suburban landscape is going to look like. And so the book is a profoundly important look at those transformations.
It's so important. I really encourage everybody to go read it. Alec is just, he gets right down to what it means for everyday people's lives, how gigantic Amazon has become.
That's it. Next up, we talked to Jane Costin of the New York Times about Marco Rubio wading into the Alabama Amazon union vote. She reacted to his op-ed in USA Today.
I think this represents an effort at hostage taking. Hot Air's a la pundit made the case that, like, let's say Amazon were a very conservative-leaning company. There's no way Marco Rubio is saying this. There's no way this op-ed happens. This is a culture war issue that happens to involve unions. And especially because the op-ed, if you read it, doesn't really go into why Amazon workers are unionizing or into unionization writ large, which he clearly thinks is bad, except when it's Amazon, which he's angry at for other reasons.
He probably should have just, like, not waded into this fight because, yeah, I know that he's trying to signal, like, no, I'm a little different, a little more pro-worker. So in this instance, I'm going to back the workers here. But it's not because of any reasons they're unionizing. It's because I hate Amazon and they've got a woke HR department, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. So it was a very tortured kind of an argument.
It's all, yeah, there's a lot going on there. It's like I said, I almost fall on your side, which is either do it or don't. You know,
right.
either go in for the legit economic reasons. But going on the cultural front, it delegitimized, you know, a lot of the, I think in terms of a lot of the efforts in order to try and make this new type of politics a thing, and it frames it explicitly, maybe in a way where you could get more true conservative buy-in, but which will not enable any real serious effort to rein in Amazon. And I think that's the problem.
That is the problem.
Yeah. Finally, contributing editor at Jacobin, Matt Karp, he joined us to explain why the Biden stimulus package is not a step towards social democracy. Let's take a listen to that argument.
We're in an age of, I call it budgetary liberalism, and that's something different. It's not like the Obama era. It is more muscular in that sense, and it can do more good. That said, there's a real difference between a one-year budget and a, you know, structural change. I'm a Bernie-crat. I'm a 2016 Bernie-crat. You know, we want $15 minimum wage. We want Medicare for all. We want deep changes in the labor law that allow the working class to actually organize and gain, claw back some power from this outrageous billionaire class that dominates our society and our economy. And this bill doesn't do any of that, and it specifically failed to do the minimum wage. And so, we have to confront that this advance also does not necessarily portend advances in those directions, in the direction of structural change.
We shall see.
Reportedly, that's the only way to say it.
Reportedly, Biden's very excited to be bigger and bolder than Obama. Reportedly, he's thinking of actually getting rid of the filibuster, whether Joe Manchin would go along with that or not, whether Joe Biden is really committed to that or not. We shall see. But yeah, as it stands, it is a good relief package, emergency relief package. All the provisions are temporary. So the idea that it's going to, like, bring a social democracy or fundamentally shift anything is just kind of silly.
I think you're right. And it's all the details, whether he's actually going to push forward or not. We have no idea. I think Biden is doing on par better than I probably expected him to. But there's a lot of rope in order to hang yourself. We don't know yet. We'll see.
That does it for us. We'll be back later today with the week that was in media screw-ups.
Mm-hmm. Hit the subscribe button. You don't miss any of our videos. Don't forget to like and share as well. Tomorrow, going to be back for another round of hashtag Rising Qs. We'll see you all then.
Have a good one, guys.